come after me, deny yourself, take up your cross daily, and follow me. We don't even like the term follow me. I mean, honestly, we would rather lead him. You know? Jesus, this is what I'm going to do in my life, so I want you to follow me and help me along. Okay? And I'll pull you out every once in a while, and you help me do what I want to do. We want to lead Jesus, not follow him. We don't want to wake up and go, God, what do you want me to do today? Here's a decision I've got to make, and here's what I want, and here's what you want. You're going this way. You know what? I'll follow you. I'll deny myself of the road I want to take, and I'm going to follow you. That's what it means to follow Jesus. I deny myself, I take up my cross, and I truly follow him. Now that's hard. That's hard to stomach, and that's why the very next verse, Jesus says, whoever wants to save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for me will save it. He's saying, okay, listen, what I called you to is difficult, and some of you, you don't want to die. You don't want to give it all up. He goes, you know what? Then don't. But I'm telling you, he who wants to save his life, if you're listening, you're thinking, I don't want to go to the cross. I don't want to die. I don't want to give up all these things. I don't want to deny myself. He says, you know what you're going to end up doing? You're going to lose your life. He goes, but if you lose your life for me, then you're really saving it. You're really going to find it. He's saying a couple things there. One, he's telling his disciples, if you are willing to follow me to death, you're going to find out that when you gave up your life, you didn't really give anything up. Actually, it really saved your life by doing that. See, for example, Peter. Peter, who said, you're the Christ, and follows him. Peter was crucified upside down, from what tradition tells us. He was crucified upside down. He gave his life up. But let me ask you something. When he gave his life up, when he died at that moment, did he really die? No. What did he find at that time? He probably found that he had more life then than ever. At that moment, he realized by giving up his life, he actually saved his life. And those who were trying to hold on to their lives and keep everything for themselves, they were going to find out at the end of their lives, they really blew it. They lost it. Not only that, but it's talking about for those of us who have denied ourselves and given things up. I mean, think about this. Think back. Think back to before you really followed Jesus Christ. And think about the things you follow, the things you were into, the sin that was in your life. And it was hard to give that up, wasn't it? It was difficult. You're like, oh, I'll let go of it. I'll deny myself. I'll lose it. Now that you've given it up and you look back at that, do you ever look back and go, man, I wish I was still a drug addict. I wish I was still, you know, addicted to whatever it was. I wish I was still cheating. I wish I was still, you know. Or do you go, man, I found so much more life now that I've given that up. And I have so much more in Jesus now. My relationship with God is so tight and so wonderful. I would never go back to that because now I found real life. Like Jesus said, the thief comes to steal, kill, and destroy. I came to give life. I came that you may have life and have it to the full. And it's once we let go and deny ourselves and we lose our lives, we realize, man, I really didn't lose anything. Yeah, it was difficult. Yes, I gave that up. But man, look at my life now. And for all of eternity, we'll be saying that. That was really no sacrifice. And then he says this next statement, which this verse is so powerful. You've got to memorize this verse. Okay, you have to memorize this verse. Otherwise, don't come back next week. Verse 25, it says this. What good is it for a man to gain the whole world and yet lose or forfeit his very self? He says, it's very simple. What good is it for a man to gain the whole world? Let's say you get the whole world. Okay, let's think about what that would mean. Let's say you don't deny yourself, okay? You don't deny yourself. You get everything you want. Whatever feels good, just do it. Just go after it. And let's say you get everything you want. Okay? You gain the whole world. Let's say billions and billions of dollars. Okay? You got an unlimited amount of money. And let's say you live to be 100. In perfect health. At 100, you're still, you know, playing ball. You're running around. You're happy. You're healthy. You feel great. At 100 years old. 100 years, you know, from being a billionaire of all these years, you've got mansions everywhere, you're traveling the world, anything your heart desires. You can experiment with any type of drug, all the women you want, all the men you want, whatever you want, you got it all, okay? This is 100, I mean, just everything your heart desires, you get. You're famous. You don't ever, you know, ruin your reputation by following Jesus and preaching. None of that. You deny it. You just have an absolute blast. Say, for 100 years, you did it. You lived the happiest life of anyone who has ever lived on this earth. Let's just say you just had the most fun, most pleasure, and then you die. You die, and what would that, let's say the first 30 seconds of being in hell. Okay, the Bible describes hell as total darkness, and yet at the same time it refers to it as a lake of fire. So you're in this burning heat in total darkness. It says that you'll hear this weeping and gnashing of teeth, just this wailing everywhere for 30 seconds. These are Jesus' words as he described that destiny. After 30 seconds of being in that darkness and knowing this is what life's going to be from here on out, are you going to look back at the 100 years and go, well, it was worth it? Maybe. But how about after an hour or a day? How about after a year? How about after 100 years of that? Think about that. You had your 100 years of pleasure, now 100 years total torment. How about 200 years or 300 years? Realizing you've got thousands to go, you've got all of eternity, and that's all you have to look forward to forever. At what point will you finally go, it wasn't worth it? See, Jesus' statement is, what good is it? What gain is it if you gain the whole world? Okay, you got it all, but then you forfeit or you lose your very self. Matthew and Mark use the word your very soul, meaning your soul is your real self. So what? You had a great time here on earth. You got to keep all those things. You didn't have to give up anything for Jesus. He says, but then at the end, you lost your soul. You forfeited. You freely gave it up. You made a decision and said, I love this stuff so much, I'm going to hold on to it. And yes, you know, yeah, I'll lose my soul, but I'm going to have a good time now. And Jesus, would you think about that? That's really worth it to you? That really makes sense to you? To give up your soul for the sake of gaining the world for a few years? See, while Jesus' words are difficult and we go, ooh, I got to deny myself. Ooh, I got to take up my cross, be willing to die. Oh, man, I got to give up all that. I have to follow him. He says, well, what's the alternative? You're going to just go for the world and give up your soul? What are you going to do? It's like in John 6 when, you know, he has those crowds of people, and after he's done preaching, everyone leaves except for his 12 disciples. And he goes, are you guys going to leave too? Peter goes, where would we go? You've got the keys to eternal life. Jesus says, "What is it really worth it?" Now, I understand that by talking about hell, that is a very, very offensive thing to talk about in our day and age. And even when I say the word hell, some of you cringe. And you just go, man, why would he even talk about that, much less describe it? Two reasons why I bring it up. One is because of verse 26. In verse 26, Jesus says, if anyone is ashamed of me and my words, the Son of Man will be ashamed of him when he comes in his glory and in the glory of the Father and of the holy angels. Jesus says, are you ashamed of me? Are you ashamed of my words? See, I didn't give you any words of hell that I made up. These were Jesus' words. I'm just quoting him. And I'm just saying, I'm not ashamed of that. I do believe in hell because Jesus taught about it. And I'm not ashamed to say that. I'm not saying I'm thrilled about it or whatever else. I'm just saying I believe in it. And I'm not ashamed of his words because I don't want him to be ashamed of me. You know, so many people say, ooh, you know, we're not going to believe in that anymore because we don't really like it. You're being ashamed of Jesus' words. You're saying, well, he said that, but I want to fit in and I don't want to believe in it. No one believes in it today. You know, it's funny. There have been pastors and people that worked at other churches that have told me, we're not allowed to say hell from up front. Because, you know, with all the church growth experts are saying, you know, you talk about hell and people aren't going to come anymore. It hasn't worked for me. So, but the idea is you know what? We cannot be ashamed of what Jesus talked about. Look, even if it's unpopular, even if no one wants to hear about it, I have to say, Jesus, I don't want you to return. When Jesus Christ returns, I don't want him to be ashamed of me. You see, that's the verse that always pops into my head whenever I get that nervous feeling of, should I say anything about Jesus? No. No, I don't want him to think I'm dumb. I'm ashamed. And this verse, man, it just rings in my head. You ashamed of me? I'll be ashamed of you. You deny me on earth, I'll deny you in heaven. It's not even about, oh, I don't want to be fearless. I can't afford to be fearless. I can't afford to be fearful. Because I don't want Jesus to deny me. I don't want Jesus ashamed of me. I stand up and I say, I believe in Jesus. But I also bring up this whole thing of hell because, look, when I became a Christian, it wasn't because I heard a message and I fell in love with God. I'll be honest with you. That's not what motivated me. I heard a message and I heard about hell and I said, I don't want to go there. And I know that I've sinned against God. I know I've offended him. And I know that I have every right to be sent to hell. And I need a Savior. And Jesus took that for me. But it was out of that fear. And I tell you, you know why I got fired up in high school and I started sharing with all my friends about Jesus? Was because in my mind, I just thought to myself, I'd look at some of my closest friends and I'd think, I don't want that guy going to hell. I don't want her spending eternity in hell. And that's what motivated me to share with them. And honestly, the less I thought about hell, the less I would share with my friends. It's really that simple. And Satan's biggest plan is for us to be ashamed about talking about it. So we never think about it, and then there's no urgency to our message. And there's a real urgency. You know, even knowing that I was going to bring this stuff up this weekend, you know, this week is just praying and fasting and saying, God, you know what? There's going to be people here this weekend that hear, and they're headed for hell, and I can't stand that thought. They need to be saved. Save them. Draw them to yourself. You're the only one that can do anything. You understand what Jesus is saying here? It's simple. He's telling his disciples, you want to follow me? Deny yourself. You may die following me, but trust me. Because when you give up your life, you're going to find something. You're going to find more life than ever. Understand the depth of what he's saying. I bring this up because I'm willing to bet some of you came in here thinking, well, I want to hear some of the teachings of Jesus. I hear that Jesus was a good man. I believe he was a good teacher. But you just stop there. You go, well, he just has some good principles to follow. No, you don't have that option. Jesus told his disciples, listen to what Jesus told his disciples, die. Die following me. Suffer, be tortured following me. Deny yourself the things you want. He was talking to men who were going to be killed, who were going to have to leave their families and be martyred for their faith. And he's telling them, do this because once you die, if you believe in me, you're going to have eternal life and you're going to rule with me one day. And you're going to say that he was just a good teacher or a good man? Is a good man going to tell these people to die in his name if he knew in his mind he really wasn't the Son of God and there was no eternal life? Of course not. So you've got a choice. Either you've got to say that what Jesus said was true and he really was the Son of God and he had every right to tell him that, or you have to say that he was the most disgusting, wicked, evil man to ever walk this planet. He was more evil than Hitler. He makes him look like an angel. Why? Because Jesus has told millions of people through the ages, you suffer for me. You deny yourself for me. You die. You be tortured. You do what it takes. You be burned at the stake. But hold on, because when you die, you'll be with me for eternity. And so if he said that, either he was telling the truth or he was lying, and you've got to make a choice. What was he doing at that moment? He's telling the truth. Was he the Messiah? Or was he a wicked man who was just causing all these people to suffer needlessly, leave their families for no reason? See, I don't know what your parents tell you or told you growing up. I don't know what your kids tell you. I don't know what your wife tells you. It doesn't really matter who they say Jesus is at this point. The question that I'm going to ask you is the same question that Jesus asked his disciples, and that's this. But you, who do you say that I am? What about you? It doesn't matter what anyone else in your family believes right now. It's you personally. Who do you say Jesus Christ is? And are you ashamed of that? Are you willing to say, like I would say right now, I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. He died on the cross for my sins. You could stick a gun to my head right now and tell me that you would blow my brains out if I did not deny Jesus Christ. And I would say, forget you. Jesus Christ is the Son of God. He is everything to me. And I will die for that. And I'm not ashamed of that. Do you understand that that's what Christians have done through the ages? It's easy for me to say this up here, you know, in a place where it's going to be friendly. But do you understand why they got baptized? I mean, Jesus commanded it. But do you understand, when they got baptized, it was this public baptism. The first day, you know, Peter preaches, 3,000 of them go down to the river. They get baptized. But do you understand, baptism was this public confession. It was just bringing it out in the open, saying, look, I believe in Jesus Christ. I'm not ashamed of it. Do you understand that some of them, after getting baptized, they were killed? The persecution was so great, but they were willing to take it. They were publicly saying, look, I believe Jesus died, he rose again, and I am dying to my old life, and I am coming up to follow him, and I'm not ashamed of that. And shortly after, many of them were killed for their faith. Many of them lost their families. Their families disowned them, ostracized from the temple, losing so much. But they said, I'm not going to be ashamed of Jesus because I don't want him ashamed of me. And many people, 3,000 people that first day, said, we'll take whatever punishment. You're going to kill me, but I believe this with all my heart. Have you ever made that decision to follow Jesus Christ? Have you ever decided to follow him and just say, you know what, God? I believe you are the Messiah. Jesus Christ is the Son of God. He was, Isaiah 53, pierced through for my iniquity. He was crushed for my iniquity. Pierced for my transgressions. He died for me, and I will follow him to death. If you've never done that, I encourage you to do that today. The worship team's going to come up, and during this song, I'll be standing over there by the prayer room. And if you're ready today to say, you know what, I want to follow Jesus now, and that means coming up here and getting baptized right after this song,